Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to get underway. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. I'd like to invite Stacy Terris, who will do the next introduction.
Good morning, everyone. Dr. Daniel Todman, our next speaker, senior lecturer in modern history, Queen Mary University of London. After receiving his PhD from Cambridge, he first taught in the War Studies Department of the Royal Military Academy, Sandhurst. Today, his research focuses on social, military, and cultural history of war in Britain during the 20th century. In 2003, he collaborated with Alex Danchev to co-edit The War Diaries, 1939-1945, of Field Marshal Lord Allenbrooke. Of note was the publication of his 2005 book, The Great War, Myth and Memory, when he was named in the Times Higher Educational Supplement as Academic Author of the Year. The first volume of Daniel's massive two-part history of Britain in the Second World War, Britain's War, Volume 1, Into Battle, 1937-1941, was published in 2016. The second volume, Britain's War, Volume 2, A New World, 1942-1947, is due for release autumn of 2019. This morning, Daniel will speak on Churchill in 1942. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Daniel Todman.
Well, thank you very much. And thank you for the opportunity of speaking here today. What I'm going to do is to talk about one of the most important years of the Second World War, 1942, and explore the implications for how we think about Winston Churchill as war leader and as Prime Minister. And what I want to do is to give Churchill the historian's respect of treating him seriously and critically, and to demonstrate, I hope, that whether or not one accepts the mythos around him, you have to recognize him as a fascinating and important person who deserves and requires understanding, respect, and study. So why 1942? Well, although 1940 gets most of the attention, 1942 has, I think, better reason to be seen as the year that defined the outcomes of Britain's war. So 1940, with Churchill's arrival in Downing Street, the fall of France, and the beginning of the Blitz on British cities, had seen the end of the long pre-war. During 1941, with the passing of Lend-Lease, the Nazi attack on the Soviet Union, and the move to war in the Pacific and Southeast Asia, the European and Asian conflicts finally combined into a great global conflagration. By the end of 1942, however, the consequences for the UK of that struggle, Axis defeat, the end of the British Empire in India and Burma, the need to find an accommodation with Soviet and American power, and the mix of production and welfareism that would dominate domestic reconstruction had all become much more clearly apparent. 1942 was a year of humiliating defeats for the forces of the British Commonwealth, but also of re-equipment, recovery, and victory in ways that would define how they fought during the last part of the war. On the home front, Britons were remarkably safe. More people died in road accidents in the UK in 1942 than from the actions of the Luftwaffe. Not all of those road accidents were caused by drunk GIs, but some were. But the mobilization of peoples, factories, and raw materials moved into a new gear, bringing the all-involving, make, do, and mend, ration-booked austerity that for many Britons still defines their imagined experience of the war. Well, not least because of the efforts and words expended on 1940, 1942 has, I think, been quite poorly served by historians of Britain's war. The established narrative, as I'll explain, is often divided in ways that make it hard to understand the continued but changing nature of British power and Churchill's reactions to a rapidly changing world. So a commonly accepted version of 1942 usually starts by emphasizing the shock of the loss of Fawcett, the loss of Hong Kong and of Singapore, often with much less attention paid to the knock-on effects of the incomplete victory of Operation Crusader in the Western Desert. The loss of Singapore is normally taken as marking an immediate end to the British power in Southeast Asia. Here it goes, as British servicemen push a car off the harbour in Singapore to make sure it doesn't fall into Japanese hands, laying the ground for a discussion of the Cripps mission in India, but allowing a shift back to a consideration of strategy that focuses primarily on Europe. Most time, as we heard this morning from Alan, is dedicated to debates between the British and Americans centred on the West, not just the allocation of resources to the air war over Europe and the Atlantic, but also to the arguments over a second front. 1942 is also seen as a decisive moment in Labour's wartime march, including not only the rise of Stafford Cripps, walking with destiny with Churchill on the deck of HMS Victorious late in 42, but also the strengthening of Attlee and Bevin's place within the War Cabinet, and by clear bi-electoral evidence of a popular swing to the left, a radical enthusiasm for fair shares for all and equality of sacrifice that rejected the failures of the 1930s and foretold Labour's victory in 1945. Well, in these contexts, Churchill's great successes are seen as political survival, despite the anger of conservative backbenchers, culminating in the no-confidence debate after the fall of Tobruk, and strategic control, seizing on Roosevelt's enthusiasm for a North African adventure to commit the United States to the Torch invasion, then flying to Moscow via a reorganization of the High Command in Cairo to break the bad news to Stalin. Cripps, frustrated with the machinery of strategy making, could be dissuaded from rocking the boat with a resignation until the outcome of that invasion was clear, at which point Churchill became politically unassailable, a moment celebrated by his public insistence that he had not become First Minister to preside over the dissolution of the British Empire. Ironically, however, the bells pealing for the North African victories also rang in the Beveridge Report to Labour advantage and Conservatives' confusion. So the tide had turned in more ways than one. So without totally disputing that account, I want to highlight three elements of it for you. First, it embodies a geographic division between the wars against Germany, Italy, and Japan, when in fact many of the most difficult choices faced by British strategists in 1942 were complicated by the way that those conflicts interlinked. Second, it puts potential cross-channel operations at the center of discussions. And third, the degree to which the political narrative is dominated by a retrospective knowledge of Labour's victory in 1945 and the concomitant casting of wartime conservatism as a sort of derelict project. Well, in the last decade, a range of new scholarship has significantly developed how we think about 1942. And I want to summarise some key points of that before explaining how it helps us interpret Churchill's performance during that critical year. Oh, there's Torch. There you go. So the first is the internationalization of the history of the war. So we now not only give more agency to nationalist leaders in Asia, but also to the ways in which people in India, Burma, and Malaya navigated the predicaments created by the conflict. The effect is to re-emphasize how disruptive the collapse of the Allied position in Southeast Asia was, just how vulnerable the British Empire appeared in spring 1942 to a continued Japanese drive towards the West. Meanwhile, researchers with greater access to Soviet archives have given far more credit to Stalin and Molotov's realism about what the Western Allies could achieve after the Japanese onslaught in the Far East. So their calls for a second front represented not a belief that this was something that Britain would actually do, but rather a negotiating lever to bind in the US and the UK and secure greater commitments on supply and post-war territorial concessions. In the European context, scholars have noted the ways in which Britain came to be seen as a defender of a particular ideal of the West, liberal, imperial, and between Russia and America, and the expectation that the United States would once again withdraw into isolationism at the end of the conflict. The argument that Britain therefore had to cut an early deal with the Soviet Union was one espoused by Eden and Cripps in 1942, and while in some ways it ran counter to Churchill and Lindemann's hope of Anglo-American unity, it was not an interpretation that the Prime Minister could ignore. In this regard, Churchill's belief following his first meeting with Stalin in the summer of 1942, that the Soviet dictator was a man with whom he could do business, was a highly consequential episode for what would play out over the remaining years of the war. So first, internationalization. Second, the writing back in of wartime intelligence. So one of the things that really comes out of that work is the mismatch in the spring of 1942 between quite good British awareness of German intentions, which were broadly trackable through the movements made clear through the decryption of the Luftwaffe Enigma, and their uncertainty, shared with the Americans, about exactly what the Japanese would do next after their initial successes. One of the great difficulties in establishing that was that the Japanese themselves hadn't made up their mind until that moment occurred. So third then, I think most important, is what you could call the production turn in the history of the Second World War. So this has expanded what was previously, I think, primarily seen as an economic history of the conflict into a much broader social, military, political analysis of the ways in which manufacturing war material became a dominant theme of national strategy on wartime experience. Looking at production in 1942 matters to the end of the war, because in this period, the war was too big for everyone, even including the United States, and all the combatants were busy escalating their industrial effort and mobilization of resources in an effort to fight the last years of the war. The decisions taken about what to make in 1942 would take time to work through their respective systems, but they'd prove absolutely critical to the end game of 1944-45. Indeed, in Philip Payson O'Brien's recent book, Roosevelt's mid-1942 decision to scale down the production of weapons for the US Army while maintaining the output of aircraft and increasing that of merchant shipping becomes the vital moment that determined, in O'Brien's title, how the war was won. For the British Commonwealth, the key implications of this production turn are a new emphasis on the North Atlantic production nexus, so between Britain, America, and Canada. And the part that played in sustaining the Soviet as well as the Western Allied war effort in 1941 and 1942. A realization of how long it took US industry to come online, and the long lead times and opportunity costs involved in pursuing high technology weapons. Most obviously, Britain's investment in an escalation of its strategic bombing effort during 1942 that wouldn't bear fruit until the following year. Behind the factories, this interest in the material of war has encouraged a new recognition of the importance of manpower, food, coal, and oil, and the extent to which the British relied on an imperial arc stretching from South Africa, via the Middle East, and India to Australia, to supply all of these for the wars against Italy and Japan. So that focus on the materiality of the war effort and on technology has encouraged historians to think much more about sea and air power and less about armies. And one consequence of that is to re-emphasize the importance of two key air campaigns that were already underway in 1942. The struggle for supremacy over North Africa and the Mediterranean, and the strategic bombing offensive. And the way in which both of these were already operating as genuine second fronts, requiring significant redeployments of high-performance aircraft, guns, and concrete by the Reich that would otherwise have been used against the Soviet Union. The other effect of the reappearance of the sea and air wars is to make clear that the practicalities of Anglo-American strategy, so not the potentialities, which are about a cross-channel invasion, but the practicalities, were oceanic in 1942. With a strong focus on the control of islands, including contingency plans for the seizure of the Azores and the Canaries, the seizure of Madagascar, and the protection of forward operating bases required for future defensive and offensive endeavors, as well as for the supply of the Soviet Union. The key geography of Britain's war in 1942 was therefore that of the Atlantic and the Indian Oceans, through which the vital maritime supply links ran, rather than of the Channel or of the Mediterranean. At the head of the Indian Ocean, the vast Middle East base area was crucial both to sustaining the imperial war effort in North Africa, but also as part of an interconnected supply system that defended the entire ocean. Iran, through the Persian Gulf, was a vital source of oil for the Eastern Empire, but also a key supply route into the Soviet Union. Terrifyingly for the British, between March and August 1942, this Middle East area appeared vulnerable to an attack from three sides: by the Japanese across the Indian Ocean, an Axis assault from the Western Desert through Egypt, but also a German descent through the Caucasus if the Red Army was defeated in the Southern Soviet Union. As Andrew Boyd, in his recent very good book, The Royal Navy in Eastern Waters, has emphasized, that continued Japanese threat helps to explain why the British didn't abandon the Indian Ocean after the loss of Singapore. Far from it, the Royal Navy prioritized the defense of the Indian Ocean over sending ships to the Mediterranean to keep Malta resupplied. The defense of Ceylon was put ahead of the reinforcement of India. The British staged the first major Allied amphibious operation of the war to take Diego Suarez and safeguard the shipping route up the east coast of Africa. And had a serious Japanese threat persisted into the summer of 1942, still more of growing British naval strength would have been allocated to that eastern war. So I've talked about internationalization, intelligence, and production. The fourth and final point I want to make about 1942 is about the politics of the British home front. Well, here too, production was really important. As an issue of high politics, the struggle between Ernest Bevin and Lord Beaverbrook is really a struggle about the politics of production, who gets to benefit from the mobilization of the economy and who controls it, with strong echoes back to both men's experience in the First World War. One of the great things I think about Andrew Roberts' newly published book about Churchill is the emphasis it places on the First World War as learning experience for that whole generation. And that this, you know, the second conflict is seen through the lens of what people had been thinking about as a result of the First World War. Ironically, however, the political scene in the UK remained dominated by the traditional political party political structures. Ironically, given his own frequent discomfort with the party system, a lot of what secured Churchill's position in 1942 was the difficulty of building an opposing coalition between Labour and Conservative MPs, most of whom were most concerned with making sure that the other party didn't gain the upper hand over them. So to close then, how does all of this affect how we think about Churchill walking with destiny in 1942? So there's the Eastern Fleet. Here you go. First, it strengthens the understanding of Churchill's strengths and weaknesses as a strategist. His extraordinary energy and physical and mental resilience were evident very much in the spring of 42. Enduring the humiliation of the loss of Singapore and a U-turn on policy, if not intent, with regard to Indian independence. Alan Brooke, not a man to hold back on his diary criticisms of the Prime Minister, was particularly struck by Churchill's ability to grasp the totality of a global war and to deal with defeat without being overwhelmed. And as somebody who wrote my first volume about Britain's war as something of a Churchill skeptic, one of the things that has most impressed me is just the capacity and resilience required to cope with disaster and not be totally overcome by it. In 1942. Certainly Churchill's track record had given him plenty of experience of failure with which to put these events into perspective. It's at least arguable, however, that what Rab Butler called Churchill's turn to the ancient ways and pathways of tradition in late 1942, including his insistence that we have what we hold when it came to the empire, were an emotional reaction to the buffeting of the earlier part of that year, and his frustration not just with the Americans, but with a younger, weaker generation of British politicians. As Churchill told the Spanish ambassador after his Mansion House speech, he was an old politician who understood the significance of a remark such as this, his comments about keeping the British Empire and not giving it up to anybody. But he did not wish to play to the gallery to conceal his real feelings. During 42, Churchill displayed fairly sound instincts about what was practicable in grand strategic terms, with a very strong awareness of two crucial factors, timing and technology. He didn't always make good decisions about these. Like the rest of the British strategic establishment, though in a particularly Churchillian way, he was badly caught out by the speed with which the Japanese overran Southeast Asia. the 2.1 million almost entirely useless rockets which British industry made in 1942 were an elegant testimony to his sometime wayward enthusiasm for new weapons. But in a way, getting all decisions right is less important than making decisions when it comes to a war leader. The awareness that timing and technology mattered were what encouraged what in retrospect looked like very sound decisions from the spring of 1942 onwards. Whether or not we think Churchill's policy on India was morally sound or sensible in national interests terms, his rapid about-face to consider constitutional change, if only to keep the nationalists on side and the Americans busy, was conditioned by the understanding that there was a window of vulnerability before the Eastern Empire could be reinforced. So he understands it as a period of months during which it's necessary to make some concessions, possibly just cosmetic concessions, in order to guard against the danger of an uprising in India at the same time that the Japanese are on the doorstep or coming across the Bay of Bengal. Now, as very often with Churchill's decisions, there were significant second-order effects because of the short-term nature of the way in which he operated. So in this case, particularly the way in which the failure of that constitutional offer then fed the violence of the Quit India movement in the summer of 1942. By the time that violence broke out, however, the immediate threat of Japanese intervention had gone. So the timing works in that case. Churchill's unnecessary and cruel reveling in the defeat of the protesters and his failure to recognize the loyalty of the Indian Army under those very difficult circumstances pointed to many of the problems with his attitude towards India, the prejudice, inflexibility, and simple lack of concern that alienated MPs on both sides of the House. It's worth noting, however, that according to Home Intelligence, over Quit India at least, they also reflected the, Churchill's views, also reflected the views of the majority of the British public, who, though they had supported India's right to self-rule, regarded any wartime revolt as treachery. Hanging is too good for this quisling in India, was one of the comments collected by Home Intelligence about Gandhi in the summer of 1942. Churchill's sense of strategic timing was also reflected in his relative optimism about the security of the Indian Ocean and of the Middle East. He recovered from the anxieties of early April 1942 much quicker than his staff officers. This reflected not only improved intelligence, but also his grasp that the Japanese were not capable of fighting a two-ocean offensive war, and his number-counting approach to the battleship reinforcement of the Eastern Fleet. Typically, this accurate perception that the Eastern Empire was much safer than it had been rapidly moved into overconfidence about the Royal Navy's ability to take on the Japanese fleet in daylight action and a desire for more offensive action in the Far East. Similarly, though Churchill accepted the danger of a German thrust south through the Caucasus, which was part of how he worked together with Brooke to deflect Marshall's proposals for a cross-channel attack, he also recognized how difficult it would be for any such operation to actually reach the Persian Gulf. Ironically, for a man much given to cigar butt strategy, he appreciated that in this instance, terrain and distance had really important implications. Now, while Churchill often hoped for quick solutions, he nevertheless clearly understood and accepted the essential logic of a war of production and the need for material and long-term preparations for industrial campaigns. Again, the experience of the First World War was critical. Though the slow pace and repeated defeats of the North African campaign disappointed him, particularly disappointed him with his generals, he took on board and articulated the argument that this was a location where the Allies were making an effective difference, wearing down Axis air power and making a significant contribution to the Grand Alliance. Simon Ball, in his book The Bitter Sea, argues that this was a sort of half-hearted justification, but I don't agree, not just because Churchill plainly did understand that modern war was trifibious, it involved air and sea as well as land operations, but also because it matches very well with his attitude to Bomber Command. If the bombers didn't live up to Churchill's hopes, he recognised that they required concentration and investment, and that the costs already sunk into infrastructure and aircraft manufacturing couldn't simply be abandoned at the stroke of a pen. Leo Amery, again not exactly a neutral observer of Churchill's performances in cabinet, was noticeably impressed with his common sense in dealing with the issue of bomber allocations in April 1942, when Churchill's own chiefs of staff couldn't present him with an agreed policy. When it came to the operational realization of those strategic insights, however, Churchill was much less capable and often unaware of the limitations of his understanding. His genuine interest in and desire to challenge the statistical calculations with which his commanders presented him often degenerated into what were essentially unresolvable arguments about numbers that simply occupied time that could have been spent on something else. His enthusiasm for amphibious expeditions as a means of doing something was demonstrated in his continued pressing for the occupation of northern Norway, much to Brooke's despair. Churchill's understandable concern for the security of Malta led him to ignore Auchinleck's perfectly reasonable desire to achieve a larger margin of numerical superiority before attacking in the Western Desert. Now, in most of these cases, Brooke was an important restraining force on the Prime Minister, and it's here that his presence was so valuable as Chief of the Imperial General Staff from 1942. Importantly, he helped to reduce the instability that resulted from Churchill's constant testing outflow of ideas and the danger that one of them might end up coming to pass. Now, one of Brooke's persistent complaints about Churchill was his short-termism, but in practice, it's hard to see what other approach was adoptable for much of this critical year. As the widening war presented Britain with a series of crises, just keep buggering on was perhaps the only means of keeping going. To this extent, the compressed timeframes of 1942 arguably suited Churchill's personality very well. Nonetheless, it's clear that his instinctual reaction to knotty, longer-term problems that he found distasteful was to put them off for the future. Internationally and domestically, this stored up some very significant problems for the future. One area where Churchill plainly was already engaging with the long-term was the need for continued American financial support for British economic reconstruction. It was indicative of the effects of the war that the timetables for securing that were no longer in Britain's control. So a good example of that is that by the summer of 1942, the British had a well-argued out position about what John Maynard Keynes could take across the Atlantic and negotiate on in terms of a post-war economic settlement. They weren't able to make any progress on that, not because the British couldn't agree, but because the US State Department and Treasury were having a big fight about who should control the process in Washington. On the home front, the failure to grab hold of the Reconstruction agenda as a key element of domestic policy indicated an absence of long-term political strategy. From the early summer of 42, it was apparent that Beveridge's eventual report would be a significant political moment, not least because Beveridge told everybody that at great length and across newspapers, radio interviews, and everything else. Important voices in the government, including Bevan and Attlee, urged on early promises on improved welfare and education. Churchill's instincts typically were more material, withstand further austerity, and make sure there was plenty of beef and beer to keep the workers happy. Since 1940, he tried to avoid any discussion of reconstruction because he thought it would be too disruptive for the coalition. He was genuinely concerned about what could be afforded after the war and unwilling to enter into commitments that couldn't be fulfilled. Even so, it's hard not to see this as a moment of political possibility that he let slip. Richard Toy, in his wonderful Jewel biography, makes the point that Lloyd George was the better democratic politician at war, that his skill set encompassed the need not just to direct national strategy, but also to outmaneuver opponents by sniffing the wind and making promises of the better world to come. Ironically, of course, the very success of this approach in 1917 and 1918, and its subsequent disappointment in 1920-22, made it much harder for any government in 1939-45 to make a commitment to reconstruction that the people would believe. The comparison with Baldwin is just as instructive. There was an obvious route to conservative electoral success in the 20th century, and it involved repeatedly recognizing, redefining, and capturing the middle ground. It would also have been an important approach to mobilizing popular enthusiasm for the second half of the Second World War. When it came to reconstruction, however, Churchill did not try to do this until it was too late. And he then devoted too little time and effort to a task that would have required great political subtlety. Why should he have done so, perhaps, when his public status was so tied to his all-out commitment to victory? To that extent, however, he more than deserved to lose the 1945 election. Thank you.
Unfortunately, we don't have time for questions, ladies and gentlemen. I have to give you instructions for lunch. Lunch is going to be served buffet style in the Tidewater Room, which is the same room where you had breakfast, just out these doors and down the hall. And we invite you then to bring your meal back into here in approximately 20 minutes, and our lunch program will begin here on the platform at that time. Thank you.
No, that's fine.